It's the fastest growing city on the planet. It's got a population the size of Greater New York. But chances are, unless you're Chinese, you haven't even heard about it. Well, it's about time you did. Welcome to Chongqing, China's secret metropolis. So,
I know what you're thinking. Chongqing? Did he just make that name up? No. But I would agree that you'd be hard-pressed to find a more Chinese-sounding name than that. The only unreal thing about this city is the scale of its growth, both in terms of population and economy. Construction activity here is unmatched by any other city anywhere, and last year its economy grew by 16.4%. The several hundred new high-rises built annually reflect a need to house a lot of people really fast. No wonder, because 1,300 people move here every day. In this film, I'll try to answer such questions as, how can a city the size of New York not be a household name in the West? Why does Chongqing's economy grow at twice the rate of the rest of China? And not least,
what makes 500,000 people move here every year?
We'll find out what this city has been through in the past. We'll see the enormous state of change that envelops it today. And we'll explore its magnificent plans for the coming decade. But we'll also get a first-hand glance at Chongqing's most distinguishing characteristic, the people who live here. But let's start at the beginning. The earliest accounts of settlements in Chongqing date back to 316 BC, that is, more than 2,300 years ago. Back then, it was the capital of the legendary state of Ba. Ever since it was first settled, the city has been a busy port town, a point of departure for goods traveling from the western part of China to the east. It received its current name, which means double celebration, in 1189 in honor of Prince Zhao Dun's double crowning as both king and emperor of the Southern Song Dynasty. At this point in time, I think it's safe to say that Chongqing is blossoming, or at least on the verge of blossoming. But a few of those who live here today are plagued by horrifying memories.
Capital of China takes Japanese air raids as usual. Under the guidance of Madame Chiang Kai-shek and her sisters, the Chinese are continually rebuilding the city. Modern structures of brick and masonry replace the old. Here is proof that a city is as strong as its people. Old China, serene, grim, determined, fights on. Chiang Kai-shek at the helm.
In 1937, at the start of the Second Sino-Japanese War, or the Anti-Japanese War as it is known here, Japan invaded China and occupied large parts of its eastern seaboard. Nationalist Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek decided to make Chongqing his provisional wartime capital. That decision would come at a terrible cost for the city's population. According to the prevailing Japanese approach to air warfare at the time, the bombing was focused on the civilian population, and targets were usually schools, hospitals, and residential areas. Between 1937 and 1943, Japanese planes performed more than 5,000 bombing raids over the city, slaughtering civilians by the tens of thousands and destroying some 17,000 buildings. Among the ruins of some recently demolished old buildings, we found a 92-year-old woman who witnessed the horror firsthand.
你记得我还是在做。
你可不可以<笑><笑><笑><笑><笑><笑><笑><笑>
Here's a woman who survived Japanese bombing, miles greatly forward, and the Cultural Revolution. And you can't get through all that without the right attitude.
你小一点，小一点。不是那样子。<laughs>
Bomb shelters were built across the city, and thousands of lives were undoubtedly saved by them.
Now, 75 years later, some of these bomb shelters are still in use, albeit for a slightly different purpose.
Because the threat of Japanese bombing is no longer imminent, this bomb shelter has been turned into a restaurant. But where is Chongqing precisely? Deep in the Chinese heartland, actually just as close to Bangladesh as to Shanghai, where the mighty Yangtze River meets the Jialing, a colossus is rising out of the fog. Chongqing is, whichever way you measure it, a gigantic city. Precisely how gigantic depends on how you calculate, because the municipality of Chongqing incorporates a lot more than just the city. With a geographical area the size of Austria, It also includes a large rural hinterland. But if you get into a car in the middle of the city and drive for 1 hour in any direction, there is no pause in urban agglomeration. Only high rises as far as you can see. Within this area, called the 1 hour economic circle, 18 million people live, about the same as the New York City metropolitan area. Historically, the center of the city has been the Yujiang district. But because Chongqing is now such an enormous urban agglomeration, each of the city's districts have become vast cities in their own right, situated around their own central squares. Shopping Ba, for example, one of the westernmost districts, has more than 1 million residents and a dizzying array of high-rise buildings. And that is just one of many such satellite city centers. Others include Guanyinqiao, Zhoulongpo, Nanping, Daping, and Yubei. But this city isn't nearly done growing yet, because beyond that 1 hour radius, another 14 million people populate the rest of the municipality, giving it a total population of 32 million, about the same as Canada. And increasingly, people in the rural areas of Chongqing are moving to its urban core, which is now growing by 500,000 per year. The new citizens who move to the city add about 15 million to the city's economy every day. Since these people come to work and live in Chongqing, 137,000 square meters of residential, office, and factory space is constructed every day to accommodate them. That's about the same area as 23 football fields, daily. So all around you, day and night, you can hear the anthem of urbanization. To make room for all the new inhabitants, and to do it in an environmentally sustainable way, Chongqing is building high-rises at an unmatched pace. And that means the work never stops. A high-rise is commonly defined as a building of more than 35 meters. Officially, Hong Kong, with around 7,000, and New York, with around 6,000, are the cities with the most high-rise buildings. These same statistics claim Chongqing has around 500 of these. But for anyone who's ever been to Chongqing, it's plain to see that this can't possibly be the case. Precisely how many high-rise buildings there are here is hard to say, but they certainly number in the thousands. One reason why the figures are so underreported is that it is impossible for the statisticians to keep up with construction activity here. Most of the high-rises you see here in Jiangbei, for example, didn't even exist 5 years ago. As far as megacities go, Chongqing is still only in its adolescence. But it's undergoing a transformation so fast and on such a scale that the likes of it has never been seen in history. It seems every part of this city is under construction. But if you know where to look, you can find places where time seems to be standing still. To make room for relatively more energy-efficient high-rises, the more primitive settlements of the old quarters must yield. Most of these buildings are marked in a scary red, with the character Chai, a death sentence for a decrepit old neighborhood. But most of the residents here are okay with that. They've been compensated with new high-rise apartments, replete with washing machines and refrigerators. Most Chinese are not interested in preservationist campaigns. To them, running water and reliable electricity trump nostalgia. Chongqing is a city that takes its infrastructure seriously, and also one that's making an honest effort to be environmentally friendly. With its four lines and 77 stations, Chongqing's metro network is by no means enormous, and actually strikingly small for such a large city. But keep in mind that the first line was only opened in 2005, and that the daily ridership already exceeds 900,000. But what's truly astonishing about this metro network isn't what it is today, but rather what it'll soon become. The city plans to complete another 13 metro lines within the next 15 years, which will make it one of the world's largest metro networks. Apart from being a swift and reliable means of transportation, it's a convenient way to get spectacular views of the city. Due to its characteristic topography of mountains and rivers, Chongqing has become the bridge capital of China and home to some of the world's largest bridges. But the city's engineers are not resting on their laurels. Between Nanping and Yuzhong districts, and then onward to Jiangbei, two enormous twin bridges are being erected as we speak, in record time. The bridges will both be double-deckers, with cars on the upper deck and the metro on the lower, and will be connected through a tunnel going straight through the mountain under the downtown area. They'll have a monumental effect on both the Chongqing skyline and economy as they link the city's main financial district with the very quickly developing areas of Jiangbei and Nanping. It's as if New York were to build both the Brooklyn Bridge and the George Washington Bridge at the same time, and in just 3 years. When you look at the city, with its tall buildings, massive bridges, and a plethora of shops and restaurants, it's hard to believe the average disposable income here is only about $3,000 USD per year. That's only $250 per month. But then try to imagine what this place will look like in about a decade, when that purchasing power has quadrupled. The exhibition at the Urban Planning Museum gives us an idea. Internationally, Chongqing still hasn't gained the notoriety it one day will. But among the Chinese, it's already celebrated. It's best known for its three kinds of hot. Hot weather, hot food, and, well. Together with Wuhan and Nanjing, Chongqing is one of China's so-called three furnaces, a categorization it's earned because of its oppressively hot and humid summers, a time of year when the mercury frequently reaches 35 degrees Celsius or more. The Chongqingese are both fond and proud of their local culture and way of life. Most prominent is hot pot culture. The hot pot has become an institution in these parts, a place where families or groups of friends go to enjoy communal meals. Each table has a deep pot embedded in the middle, filled with spicy cooking oil and peppers so hot they can quite literally numb your mouth. By the banks of the Yangtze River, we paid a visit to a hot pot restaurant a little bit out of the ordinary, specifically a communist-themed restaurant. This guy seems to have done his homework about historic Chinese communists, but what about the foreign ones? Oh, those revolutionary Swedes. The Chongqingese like having fun. On weekends, or at night on weekdays, they gather in the city's many open squares and dance their worries away. Regular exercise is good for your health, and since they're not interested in treadmills, dance is a good option. More easily said than done. Walking backward is also supposed to be good for you. These women are playing mahjong. That's a game they have special tables for and which almost all Chongqingese are very fond of. The aim is pretty simple. You need to get three in a row or four of a kind. And it's not interesting unless there's money involved. You can hear the clicking of tiles almost no matter where you are in the city. The arts are also well represented. The city just got a brand new museum of modern art. And here, in Jeollabo, the students at the Academy of Fine Arts have decorated most of the buildings in the neighborhood. In the West, we harbor certain preconceptions about the Chinese as a cold and distant, expressionless people. At least in Chongqing, that could not be farther from the truth. They are warm and open, funny and curious, and not at all afraid to engage a stranger in conversation. But more importantly, they don't take themselves too seriously. In Chongqing, they don't speak normal Mandarin Chinese. They speak something called Chongqing Hua. And this is what it sounds like. Chongqing is probably the largest non-cosmopolitan city in the world. Only about 10,000 foreigners live here, which means that about 99.9% of the population is ethnically Chinese. But many new foreigners come here every year to make money from a rising tide. So why is Chongqing's economy growing so fast? Well, there are at least four big reasons. The first is the incredible urbanization process that adds to the city's economy about 500,000 consumers and producers a year and at least $15 million a day. The second has to do with central government policy. Since Deng Xiaoping's economic liberalization and China's opening to foreign trade some 3 decades ago, China has undergone a sweeping economic transformation, from abject poverty to modest wealth. Most of this growth has until recently been propelled by exports and foreign direct investment. But due to the economic navigation errors committed in the ordinarily rich world, these sources of growth have rapidly diminished. That's a big problem for the Communist Party, who owes its legitimacy to economic expansion and the improvement of living standards in China. And with the threat of national disintegration and ethnic strife perpetually at its doorstep, China can scarcely afford to stagnate. So, the 7 neatly groomed men of the Politburo's Standing Committee, a group which ironically spends most of its time sitting down, are intent on finding more baskets in which to place their fragile eggs of economic growth. And the course they've decided to follow is one in which Chongqing plays an integral part. One of the economic growth drivers pursued by the central government is increased domestic consumption. The Chinese have a vast pool of savings, which the guys in Beijing want people to dip into. The average Chinese saves about half his income, in contrast to his European or American counterparts, who generally save close to or below 0%. Through various schemes, the government is now inducing these savers to spend more in order to spur consumption from within China itself. And that bodes well for Chongqing's economy, which, unlike that of the coastal provinces such as Guangdong, Fujian, or Shanghai, is not primarily export-driven. Chongqing's industries cater mainly to the demand of the Chinese themselves because of the city's strategic position on the famous Yangtze River. The Yangtze is actually not called Yangtze at all in China, but rather Changjiang, or the Long River. In fact, it's the longest river in China and the 3rd longest in the world, surpassed only by the Nile and the Amazon. This massive internal artery transported 1.3 billion tons of goods in 2009, twice as much as the Mississippi and 3 times as much as the Rhine, making it the busiest river in the world. Another policy accelerating Chongqing's economic growth is the deliberate effort to lift up the western part of China. Terrified as it is of disgruntled masses, Beijing seeks to mitigate the income gap between the cities on the coast and the relatively undeveloped west. Beijing's priority of making sure western China catches up is another aim to which Chongqing is central. And this is why Chongqing, formerly part of Sichuan province, became a direct-controlled municipality in 1997. There are 4 such municipalities in China: Beijing, Shanghai, Tianjin, and now Chongqing. This Open Up the West plan is part of a second wave of economic development in China, and right now it's washing in over Chongqing. The Chinese government is tilting investment westward through a variety of measures. One is substantial tax breaks. Companies on the coast pay 25% taxes, but here they only pay 15%. Another is massive infrastructure development. New roads, new bridges, new tunnels, everywhere I look. In a bid to move up the value chain, the government has also opened a large number of fast-growing economic and technological development zones. In the Chongqing urban area, there are more than 30 such industrial parks. The government's policies and incentive structures seem to be working. Since the city became its own municipality in 1997, it's enjoyed a double-digit average growth rate, and in the last few years, it's been growing even faster, posting rates of an unfathomable 17.1% in 2010 and 16.4% in 2011. 4.5 years of that, and you'll have doubled your economy. The third big reason for Chongqing's economic growth has to do with lower costs. Apart from the low taxes, Chongqing has another cost advantage. Land in the West is far less expensive. Real estate in Chongqing is between 1/3 and 1/4 of the price for comparable property in Shanghai or Beijing. But the most important cost advantage is that the West is the part of the country that still has a large reserve of that original great resource of Chinese. Very cheap labor. Hundreds of millions of people starting with two empty hands who say goodbye to farm life and try their luck at China's booming economy. Since Chongqing has a lot of hills with narrow alleys and steep steps, goods transport by bike or car is often impossible. That's why Chongqing has the Bangbang Army. It's composed of the men who, dressed in nothing but flip-flops and well-worn pants, carry heavy loads of up to 100 kilos on their backs, moving goods around the city. The name comes from the word bang, or bangzi, which means stick or pole, which is what they use to carry goods. More than 100,000 men strong, it's been called the world's largest moving company, and without them, this city would come to a grinding halt. They're all, of course, independent operators, men without money or education, many of whom are illiterate, who have left the countryside to make a better life in the city. The only living quarters they can afford are usually tiny shacks, which they share with many other Bangbang men. It's backbreakingly hard work, and the pay is low, but it's better than stopping in the rice paddies. Besides, they don't have a boss, and they decide their own working hours. These guys are paid in cash, so they don't have to pay taxes. It's free enterprise in its most basic incarnation. Their living expenses are so low they would make a Buddhist monk blush. So at the end of the month, there's leftover money to send back to their wife and children in the village. And this leads us to the fourth big reason for economic growth here. Economic freedom. The Chongqingese are not burdened by overzealous regulation. It's really easy to start a business in Chongqing. There's not much paperwork, small businesses pay little or nothing in taxes, and no rules require that you have wheelchair-accessible toilets, or that the kitchen was installed by a certified specialist, or that you have a permit to sell bananas on the street. It should come as no surprise, then, that Chongqing has become a small business mecca. Every day, people from the countryside flock here to set up their own little noodle stand, or shoeshine stall, or to sell umbrellas on rainy days. No government agency demands to inspect this man's 24-hour restaurants. By Western standards, he would never pass an inspection. But his food is really cheap, and people who make only $10 a day can afford to eat here. In the West, if you have no money and no one will employ you, your only choice is welfare. But in Chongqing, anyone with 100 renminbi can become their own employer. The net result of these factors, cheap land, cheap labor, low taxes, and a manageable regulatory environment, is that Chongqing becomes a place where companies can move to increase their margins. Ford, for example, one of the early movers, has its largest concentration of plants outside of Detroit in Chongqing. Hewlett-Packard churns out 30 million printers here every year. Almost half the Fortune 500 companies have already set up shop in the city, and every year, Chongqing welcomes more titans of industry and commerce. In the West, we hear a lot about jobs disappearing and going abroad. Well, this is where they turn up. And the result is hundreds of millions of Chinese moving from lives of subsistence income to middle-class comfort. Chongqing is a place where people from all walks of life come to seek their fortune. I suppose they recognize a golden age when they see one. Something big is happening in Chongqing. For the coming decades, this city will be a force to be reckoned with. How its inconspicuous yet inevitable rise will influence China and the world remains to be seen. But one thing is certain. This is only the beginning, and you have not heard the last of Chongqing.